Welcome.
Good morning.
Belgrade Online,
an online ministry of Belgrade Avenue United Methodist Church.
Hey everyone, Pastor Dan here. Hope everyone's having a fantastic weekend so far with this gorgeous, gorgeous spring weather we finally have here. Well, this morning we are closing out our series called Belgrade Avenue Church at the Movies, and it's the weekend of May 4th and May 5th, so naturally, May the 4th be with you. We're going to be talking about Star Wars this week and looking at how the intersection of our faith and the themes of that movie can teach us something about following Jesus. So we're going to be looking at Star Wars, the original Star Wars, which I think is now episode 4, called A New Hope. And it's going to be a lot of fun, but it's also going to be hopefully meaningful to you in a fun way. So hope you have a wonderful rest of your weekend, and grace and peace to you. We'll see you soon. Well, we're in our final week of our series here called Belgrade Avenue Church at the Movies, and we've been talking about stories and how Jesus' ministry on earth, anytime he taught, anytime he preached to the crowds, he always told stories. And in Mark chapter 4, verses 33 and 34, it talks about how Jesus didn't say anything without using a story to the crowds. He always used parables, he always used stories. And so I like the idea that if he were to come today, maybe he would use movies. So we've taken a fun approach to that in this series, and we've been watching different clips from a different movie each week and exploring spiritual themes in those movies. And so far, the first week, we looked at Steven Spielberg's remake of West Side Story. And then the next week, we looked at Spider-Man No Way Home. Week after that, we talked about Disney's Encanto. And then last week, we looked at the movie A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood with Mr. Rogers. I wish we could do a series on that. That is how many of you went and watched the movie this week, that one? quite a few of you. Yeah, I love that. I bought that one. Even when it's not anything sad, it's just, I love this. It's wonderful. So, but today we're closing out our series by looking at the 1977 movie Star Wars. We're looking at the original movie, and you know, it's been a popular thing for the last decade or so that every year on May 4th, we always say, May the 4th be with you, you know, May the 4th be with you. And on May 5th, we talk about the Revenge of the Sith, Revenge of the 5th, you know. So, May the 4th be with you, because the Revenge of the 5th is upon us. That's the cheesy thing I put in there. I don't know why I said that. Anyway, so I think before we get into this, I should say an extra prayer. So would you bow your heads? I'm going to pray for us. Oh God, thank you for joy. Thank you for fun and lightheartedness. We thank you that the scriptures say a merry heart is good like medicine, and the joy of the Lord is our strength. This morning, I pray that you would speak to us, that you'd fill us with your spirit, that we'd have eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts that understand what your spirit is saying to us. I ask that you transform us for your glory, in your name. Amen and amen. So, Star Wars. Well, when Star Wars was released 47 years ago, the estimated budget to make that movie was about $11 million. And since its opening on May 30th, 1977, its worldwide gross is just shy of $775.5 million, made a little bit. That's a huge profit. But when you adjust for inflation and you add promotional materials and other profits, the movie has made over $10 billion. Huge franchise. It's won 6 Oscars at the 1978 Academy Awards, as well as an insane amount of other awards. And of course, the movie we're looking at today is the movie that kicked it all off, that started off the original trilogy. Then they made another trilogy, and then another trilogy after that. And there's this whole mega universe of Star Wars, and with other stories being told within that franchise, and it's the series that we know and love today. But it all began with this movie that we're looking at, the original Star Wars, which is now called Episode 4, A New Hope. So, believe it or not, Star Wars was actually intentionally written with religious and spiritual themes baked into its premise. A lot of people don't realize that. The creator and original director of Star Wars, George Lucas, when he created Star Wars, very kind of in a similar way that ancient Hebrews would tell stories, he crafted the movie with different layers of meaning. And I wrote down a few quotes from him. Because when you, a big thing about the Star Wars movies is this concept of the Force. And so here's what he said about this. He says, "I put the Force into the Star Wars movies in order to try and awaken a certain kind of spirituality in young people, more about a belief in God than a particular religious system. The real question is to ask the question. It's about having enough interest in the mysteries of life to ask, is there a God or isn't there a God? I think there is a God, and there's no question about that." That's the creator of Star Wars and how he went about creating this. And he also said this in another interview. He says, "I wanted to try to explain in a different way religions that have already existed. I see Star Wars as taking all the issues that religion represents and trying to distill them down into a more modern and easily accessible understanding so that people can grab onto it and accept that there is a greater mystery out there." So there's definitely deep spiritual themes that are intentionally presented throughout the film and throughout at least the original three movies. And it does it in a super fun way. And it's masterfully done to the point where you don't even realize that it's happening, which is great storytelling, when you can get your theme across without smacking people in the face with it, which is why I don't really get into Christian movies too much, because they're kind of lazy about how they present their themes. It's way out on their sleeve. I love stories where it's presented to you without really even realizing it's presented to you, because that's life. That's the messiness of real life. So the thing that I realized about this movie, my kids had never seen it. So when I was prepping for this a couple Fridays ago, I said, "Hey, y'all want to watch Star Wars?" And they're like, "Yeah, this is exciting. They want to see it." And all of them fell asleep within the first half hour. Really, because like I said, this is the original one. This was made out in this came out in the late 70s. And one thing I noticed about it is that movies like this, they take a long time to develop the characters, and it takes a while to move into the story. And there's a lot of it kind of feels really slow moving. And that's one thing I kind of miss about movies today, is they don't take their time to develop the characters. They just kind of get into the action and bam, bam, bam. But if you watch the original Star Wars, you could probably cut the movie almost in half just by getting rid of extra pauses, unnecessary character dialogue, you know, the camera shots that go on extra long. So as I was thinking about it, it made me think, like, even before I started to get into any clips, that as I watched it, it really reminded me of the importance of slowing down. Because in our day and age, we have this anxiety that's inherent with our just normal comings and goings of daily life. We kind of got to go, 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 go. We're always busy. We're human doings instead of human beings. That's kind of what we've kind of devolved into in our modern society. And I think of it kind of makes us anxious. It makes us quick tempered, and it kind of puts us on edge. You know, Proverbs chapter 14 says, "A quick tempered person acts foolishly." When we're on edge, when we're constantly going, a quick tempered person acts foolishly. It bleeds into everything that we do. It helps us to make maybe decisions that aren't as solid as we would have made otherwise. But Jesus himself said this in Matthew chapter 6. He talks about it. He says, "Therefore I tell you, don't worry about your life, what you're going to eat or drink. Don't worry about your body, what you're going to wear. Life's more than food. Body's more than clothes. Why do you worry about your clothes? See how the flowers of the field grow? They don't labor, they don't spin. So don't worry, saying, what are we going to eat? What are we going to drink? What should we wear? For even pagans run after these things. But your heavenly Father knows you need them. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." In essence, it's a very specific way of saying, in our everyday life, we don't need to get so worked up about things. We don't need to go hurry, hurry, hurry. We can relax and live into the moment. We don't have to be so consumed with kind of the normal kind of anxiety that we all deal with nowadays. I'm not talking about the disorders or anything. I'm just talking about kind of the normal anxiety that's present within us. 1 Peter 5:7, the Apostle Peter writes this. He says, "Cast all of your anxiety on him, because he cares for you." He cares for you. He doesn't care for what you do for him. He doesn't care for what you can produce. He cares for you. And when somebody cares for you, they care about your well-being more than what you can produce for them. Any employers or bosses in the room, take note of that. We got to care more about people than what people can do for us. Ecclesiastes chapter 11, the writer writes this. "So then banish anxiety from your heart and cast off all the troubles of your body." Again, we're not talking about anxiety disorders. We're talking about the normal anxiety that just kind of looms over everyone nowadays, you know? So before the movie even begins, it reminds us to slow down, breathe, and be present in whatever moment we happen to find ourselves in. So the movie Star Wars starts out with the famous black screen with the yellow words crawling up, giving us the backstory of what's happening. And the movie basically has two groups. It has the evil empire, led by the menacing Darth Vader. And then you have the Rebel Alliance, the underdogs who are fighting the evil empire. And they're led by Princess Leia, the noble Princess Leia. And so the evil empire has created this gigantic, like, planet-sized Death Star. And it's capable of destruction on a massive scale. And it would make the empire unstoppable. And so before the movie begins, Princess Leia has stolen plans from this Death Star and taken them and hidden them away so that she can give them to the Rebel Alliance and they can use them to thwart the evil plans of the empire, right? So she gives this message and hides this message into this little robot, R2-D2. And R2-D2's taller gold-plated sidekick, C-3PO. And they seek out to give this message to this wise Jedi who's been hidden away, kind of reclused away from everyone, whose name is Obi-Wan Kenobi, which is always fun to say. And so he's a Jedi master, skilled into using this thing called the Force. More on that in a little bit. And so the movie begins, and Leia is captured and held hostage while the droids go for help, looking for Obi-Wan Kenobi. Meanwhile, on another planet, there's a young boy by the name of Luke Skywalker. And he struggles to find his purpose, and he's kind of verbally wrestling with his uncle on what he should do and where he should go with his life. And through a series of events, these droids run into Luke, and Luke, on accident, ends up seeing part of this message that Princess Leia gave them, and he takes the droids to go find Obi-Wan Kenobi together. They find him, and Obi-Wan notices that Luke is destined to be a Jedi. And so he becomes this mentor to Luke, and they set out to find this spaceship, somebody who can fly it, that can help them go rescue Princess Leia. And so they go on the search, And they who they find is this character, this arrogant guy by the name of Han Solo. And he turns him down, says, I'm not going to do that. But Obi-Wan throws this large amount of money at him, and he accepts it, and they board Han Solo's ship, the Millennium Falcon. And immediately, as they board this ship and they're going there, they start to be chased by enemy ships. But Han ends up outrunning them. And in our first clip here, while they're en route to find Leia, on the Millennium Falcon to rescue Princess Leia, Obi-Wan begins to teach Luke how to use this thing called the Force. And let's see what happens while that's going on in this first clip. So Luke does these Force exercises. Han Solo is skeptical about the whole thing, and he's cynical. So Luke's getting discouraged, but Obi-Wan helps him, encourage him, and give him direction, and urges him to rely on this thing called the Force, which is an all-powerful entity that gifts and grows and guides the Jedis into their power in order to use it for good. Unfortunately, Darth Vader has that same Force and used it for his own gain. And Obi-Wan is teaching Luke how to use the Force for good. Now, as Christians, we have something called the Force as well. And in John chapter 14, Jesus tells us what that is. He says this. He's talking about when he goes away. He says, I will ask the Father, and he's going to give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever. The Spirit of Truth. And I will not leave you as orphans. I'll come to you. The Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you everything that I've said to you. Peace I leave you with you, and my peace I give you. So the Holy Spirit, these description words that Jesus says about the Holy Spirit, in Greek, the word is called paraclete. Everyone say paraclete. Paraclete is the word for Holy Spirit here that Jesus used to describe the Holy Spirit here. And it means, it's kind of like a wheel. There's a lot of different spokes that it has, a lot of different aspects. But three of them are helper, advocate, and intercessor. So when the Spirit comes into our lives, it's literally like a force that's there to be Jesus with Jesus to us, but instead of with us, is actually in us, to help us, to advocate for us, and to intercede. This Spirit is promised to us by Jesus when he was leaving earth. And so would you not just go with us, but also be within us. And just like Luke is learning to use the Force and work with it, so are we learning to sense the working of God's Spirit in our own lives and to cooperate with that Spirit. And the more sensitive we can become with the Spirit, the more that we can spot the gifts that Force is developing within us. Here's what Scripture says about that. In 1 Corinthians 12, it says, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. In Romans 12, we all have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. See, what that means is that we all have giftings, and we all must discover our giftings, and then we all have to develop our giftings. And we kind of maybe think of that as an afterthought, but really this is what it means to be a part of the church, a body of Christ, to follow Jesus. 1 Timothy, the Apostle Paul writes to this young pastor named Timothy. He writes this. He says, do not neglect your gift. Your gifts, your talents, your strengths, these are the things that make your service unique to the world. Anytime we try to do anything that furthers our growth and sacrifice for it, we're going to have to do it passionately with our gifts. But Here's another aspect. Just like Han Solo in that clip was skeptical and was critical of what was happening right in front of him, we're also going to probably encounter some of that as well. Maybe from people, but maybe from experiences, because we're going to be tested. Trials are going to come. Life's going to get hard. We're going to get discouraged, and we're going to be tempted to give up and quit. And like this scene, people around us, you know, they might even criticize us for trying. And unfortunately, usually that criticism are going to come from people who are unwilling to grow. You will rarely ever be criticized by someone who is doing something. It's usually you're criticized by people who aren't doing anything, so they have to look at someone else. You know, like the couch potato watching a football game, you know, spouting off about the coach. I guarantee the coach is probably doing a better job than the dude on the couch, you know? So it's like that. But when we're tested, here's what scripture says to do in those moments. Like Luke was tested in that moment. In James 1, Apostle James says, "Consider it pure joy, my sisters and brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work within you, so that you can be mature and complete, not lacking anything." That's a universal principle. Challenges are going to come in any endeavor that you take, anytime you attempt to use your gifts. And when they show up and you feel that weight of discouragement starting to bear down on you, don't give up, but rather submit yourself to the process, just like Luke does here. It's never going to go as quickly as you want, but you'll come out on the other side and you'll have grown in character and you'll develop in skill and you'll be stronger in your abilities. And that's how your gifts and your talents and your skills develop. And we'll need to continue to rely on that force, that spirit that's greater than ourselves that Jesus has given us. That force that we call the Holy Spirit. So as the gang continues on their journey aboard the Millennium Falcon, they see that something looks like another planet or a moon up ahead. And they find themselves in a threatening situation. So let's see what happens. So they find themselves being pulled in to the Empire's space station by their tractor beam. And Luke says, "Hey, what are we going to do?" Han says, basically inevitably at the end there, he says, "We're not going down without a fight." But the clip ends with Obi-Wan saying that there are alternatives to fighting. So Han's knee-jerk response after realizing that the attempt to flee is not going to work is to get ready to fight. There's only fight or flight, and he can't flee. He can't flight, so he's got to fight. But Obi-Wan, in his Jedi wisdom, knows a better way to handle the situation. And in our lives, many things are going to happen to cause our blood pressure to rise and our fight or flight mode to kick in. And many times, we might find ourselves in a spot where we're like Han Solo in that moment, where somebody says something to us that we perceive as a shot at our character or maybe a disrespectful statement, and we begin to feel our cheeks to get flushed, our hands start to tremble a little bit, our voice gets a little shaky, and we just verbally attack. We return insult for insult. Voices escalate, harsh words are said, emotions run high. But when it happens, that never goes well. Nobody is heard, and the issue just gets worse. Because when somebody feels wronged, no matter what it is, they will feel like they're justified to wrong back. But the other person will obviously not feel that way. So now when they're wronged back, they feel wronged. And so then they feel justified to wrong the other person back again. And this creates what sociologists call a vicious cycle. And it's true in personal relationships. It's true in politics and also on large scales. It's what fuels war. But as followers of the Prince of Peace, we do not get the go-ahead to engage in things like violence, verbally or physically. When Jesus walked the earth, he was committed to peace and to harmony and to nonviolence. That's not to say that Jesus doesn't believe in standing up for others who are less powerful. But like Obi-Wan, his methods go much deeper than brute force. His fight is more clever than that. In Matthew chapter 5, he says, "You've heard that it was said, eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, don't resist an evil person. Because if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn them the other cheek as well." Because historically speaking, they would hit you on one cheek with their opposite hand. So when you turn your cheek, you would have to look them in the eye. And they would have to see your humanity when they did it. And if anyone wants to use you and to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, walk with them too. He's talking about Romans, the empire there, because they would a lot of times force them to walk a certain way for many different reasons we won't go into. But he says, offer them a second one as well. Give to the one who asks. Don't turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You've heard that it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I'm telling you to love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes the sun to rise on the evil and the good, sends rain on the righteous and on the unrighteous. If you only love those who love you, what reward will you get? Don't even the tax collectors do that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Don't even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Now that last sentence, be perfect as your heavenly Father is perfect. It's an interesting time to put that in after saying all of what he just said. Jesus is saying that being perfect is not about being like flawless. Perfection, according to Jesus, means to learn to love your enemies. And that means that we shout less and listen more. And we do this little thing called understand. Understand. James chapter 1, verse 19, he says, "My dear brothers and sisters, take note. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry." People don't usually fight if they're not angry. Proverbs 4, 7, "The beginning of wisdom is get this, get wisdom. Though it cost all you have, get understanding." Proverbs 9, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding." You want to know God? Learn how to be understanding in every situation, even when you feel your blood pressure go up. Proverbs 11, "Whoever derides their neighbor has no sense, but the one who has understanding can hold their tongue." Getting a little hot in here. Proverbs 14, "Whoever is patient has great understanding." Understanding is connected with patience. "But the one who is quick-tempered displays folly." Another word for folly is foolishness. Proverbs 17, "The one who has knowledge uses words with restraint, and whoever has understanding is even-tempered." So there's connection between understanding and not being enraged. Listening, understanding, especially when we don't feel like it, when we don't want to, is how we commit to a better way of fighting, the way that Jesus says. And like Obi-Wan mentions in that last clip, hands ready to fight, and Obi-Wan says there's a better way. So in this next clip, we see Obi-Wan modeling this. Now, it's going to, on the surface, look like he's fighting, but here's what's happening. In this next clip, they find themselves in the enemy base, trying to find Princess Leia and to free her. After this long series of events, they find her, they get past the many obstacles, they're back at the spaceship, ready for a getaway, and unfortunately, it's swarming with guards, including Darth Vader himself. So Obi-Wan runs into Darth Vader, and he's... on the surface, appearing to do the opposite of what he said, fighting Vader with his lightsabers. But then something surprising happens, and let's see what that is in this next clip. The Obi-Wan says to Darth Vader, if you strike me down, I'll become more powerful than you could ever imagine. Obi sees Luke, he smiles, and he retreats and allows Darth Vader to end him. And then just like Peter in the Gospels, Luke wants to fight back and do some violence. And if we were to keep playing, I had to cut a lot out of that scene for sake of time, but the voice of Obi encourages him to take the grace and run. And in the grand scheme of things, he helps his apprentice, Luke, on his journey to defeat the Empire and does so by sacrificing his own life for their salvation. And it's incredibly easy to see the parallel between Jesus here. And it's exactly what George Lucas was going for. And Jesus, like Obi-Wan, he may have been misunderstood in his fight. The crowds thought he was just a traditional Jewish Messiah and was thought to be the leader of a violent revolt against the evil empire. But instead, this Messiah fought the oppressor through self-sacrifice and led the salvation in this life of many of his followers. Not only that, but the example that he gave has led and continues to lead to the salvation of many. Salvation of hearts and of lives and of relationships, of jobs, of bodies, of communities, of churches, of friends, of families. Some through sustaining and some through death and resurrection. And as we continue on our journeys, that salvation leads to transformation, which, as I always like to talk about, is about growth. And as we mature in life and in faith and in character, sometimes growth means being okay with being misunderstood without retaliation. It's okay to take that understanding that we talked about a few minutes ago, realize that our fight's not with each other. It's against ideas that hurt other people. It's against theology that hurts other people. And it's about lifestyles that hurt us and other people. The fight is not with people. The good fight of faith is about learning to understand even when it hurts. I'll close with these last two scriptures and then we'll take communion together. In Ephesians 6:12, it says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but it's against the rulers, the authorities, the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. It's not with people. And it's going to take willful sacrifice. In John 15, Jesus says, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for his friends. Listen, the mark of maturity is the willing to sacrifice today, self-sacrifice today for something beautiful tomorrow. Every moment of our lives is investing today toward what we want to become tomorrow. And there's so much more to be said, and I had another clip to show you, but for sake of time and so we can take communion, we're going to just close it there. Story.
kingdom shine all around. Let my heart overflow with passion for your name. Let my life be a song revealing who you are. For you are salt and light, you are love's great height. You are deep and wide, a consuming fire. You are salt and light, you are love's great height. You are deep and wide, a consuming fire. Let my eyes see your kingdom shine. Salt and light.
We hope you enjoyed this week's episode of Belgrade Online. If it was life-giving and encouraging to you, please let us know by visiting our giving page at baumc.org/give. Thanks again for watching and have a blessed week.